welcome you to our webinar, Constructing the Vision 2020 Framework. I hope you all have a good time so far, and I hope you're all excited and thrilled by what's coming up. Hopefully a wonderful presentation. Our today's speaker will be Shilpa, and I hope Shilpa is still online. Let's hear some
noise. Hi, everybody.
Yes.
Hi, everybody.
Yes, we can hear you well. So thank you very much. It's always good in the beginning of a live webinar to check out whether all the techniques actually works. Let me just introduce our session format, and then I will hand over to Shilpa, and we will listen to her presentation. Throughout the whole presentation, you can chat with us, i.e. send some questions via the chat function of your GoToMeeting window. And then at the end of a presentation, Shilpa will try to answer all your questions. Yes, let's have a quick introduction. Why do we do this kind of webinars as an Institute for Competitive Intelligence? Well, the answer is because we're curious, because we love to learn new stuff, because we want to see what's the innovative side of competitive intelligence. And given that we are in the education business, i.e. we provide workshops, training, certification for practitioners like you are, of course you want to stay in touch with latest developments in the field. This is why on one end we do an annual conference for competitive intelligence / market intelligence, and while on the other side we do a lot of research. We invite guests like our today's guest speaker, Shilpa, and we want to simply learn again what's new, what's hot, what is something we should observe, monitor, or simply include in our own portfolio of tools, techniques in the field. And this is pretty much where I would like to introduce our speaker of the day. And then Shilpa, you have to apologize. We tried it before, but I couldn't simply pronounce your surname. So please give me a little bit of help. How is it pronounced?
It's okay, Mr. Mikhaili. You can call me Shilpa throughout. That's fine.
Yes, but for our audience, I'd love to have you name pronounced.
Great. Okay. Ashwat Narayan.
Okay, so now people, you can understand why I'm a bit hesitant to try it even. Could break my tongue, I guess. So Shilpa, that's fine for me, yeah. She's a competitive intelligence professional working at Tata Consulting Services in Bangalore, India. So this is where she's right now, and I'm sitting here in Germany. So this is why we might have a bit of noise every now and then in our line. She's a certified ambassador of the Competitive Intelligence Program of the Society of Competitive Intelligence Professionals. Currently, she leads a team that provides strategic intelligence on competition to a professional service firm. Her areas of responsibility include delivery excellence and innovation management. By now, she has 8 years of experience in research-related intelligence services. Her main areas of expertise include industry and competitor benchmarking, sentiment analysis, and media monitoring. Her clientele have comprised the C-suite, including Chief Public Relations Officer, Chief Marketing Officer, and Chief Strategic Officer, who are directly responsible for steering the strategy of their respective companies. Well, this is pretty much for what her work life is all about, so I'm glad that I can tell you that outside of her work, Shilpa thoroughly enjoys science and art in all forms, and she appreciates how one cannot survive with the other. I think this last sentence actually would be a good topic for our session as well, but no, let's talk a little bit more about her topic of the day, and this is constructing the Vision 2020 framework. So Shilpa, without further ado, it's all yours. Please go ahead and let us know what you want to tell us.
Thank you, Mr. Mikhaili, for introducing me. Good evening, everyone. And thank you for attending today's event as well. Today we will be discussing how my team applied the techniques of competitive intelligence to help a strategy team to come up with a roadmap to meet their company goals. moving on to the presentation. Okay. All right, before we move on to the actual case study, let's have a small background to the context in which this case study was conducted. All right, we understand that all the successful enterprises in today's world have a very effective competitive intelligence function. But what kind of a strategy does it pursue? Is it a push strategy or is it a pull? Now, when we say push, it's something that we all follow on a daily basis. We publish newsletters, we publish mailers, we record the events of our competitors from the market on a daily basis. We send them to the respective departments. We say what happened in the past, what happened in the last minute, what happened in the last month, what happened yesterday, what happened the year before. And then when we compile all of this, it tells us things about the past. A push is also possible when, you know, a particular requester comes to your competitive intelligence specialist and says, I need to know this, this, and this about this competitor. Give me this report. And then you put together all of the information that you have and you pass it on to the requester. That is a push strategy. What is a pull? A pull is something that you do proactively. This is not something that would come from a requester. Maybe nobody even thought about it. But you as a competitive intelligence specialist, you have tons of information that you have collected on a daily basis for a number of years. What do you do with all of that? Of course, you can buy expensive reports from Gartner, from Forrester, from all industry journals, but they too would be giving you quarterly reports, monthly reports. How do you put together what really happened in the last 5 years into one presentation? And how do you connect that to strategy is what we are going to discuss today. So we have all seen newsletters, we have seen mailers, we have seen quarterly reports, monthly reports. But what we will see today is how you can pull all of this information that you have in your computer and what use is it to you from a strategy perspective. That is what the slide was about. What is a push strategy versus what is a pull strategy? A pull is something that you do proactively and you use all of your information and connect that to the strategy of your competitors. Moving on to the next slide. Why do we need a pull strategy? Right? If you look at the current business landscape today, we can safely say it's not a static landscape. Strategies don't change on a five-yearly basis anymore. Strategy changes overnight and you get to know about it or read about it only when it comes out in the news. So today's world is a VUCA world, V-U-C-A, which means it's a volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous environment. So in this kind of a business landscape, if you have to talk about the future of your competition, it could be very predictive in nature, right? Without a particular framework in mind, you could say anything. You could come up with anything, but how do you validate that? So today we are going to discuss a framework that would help you to validate how you arrive at your competitor's predictive futuring using the information from the past. So this slide told you the status of today's business landscape. Moving on to slide number 5. Strategy, as we all know, is something that you do today and you do tomorrow and you do the day after to pursue goals in the future. So strategy is not about the past. Strategy is something that you do to achieve your future. Similarly, if you have to use your CI information, you have to move on from living in the past to going into the future. You have 3 bullet points here. Your CI information should help you to give you a futuristic, predictive, and competitive framework for your company. It cannot be restricted to just being about the past anymore. Moving on to slide number 6. how to see the big picture of the competitor ecosystem. In my experience, we normally get requests from different departments. They want to know what kind of recruiting is happening in the HR area of competitors. They want to know what investments are happening in the R&D function of competitors. They want to know how production, operations, purchasing, and supply chain have all come together to give competitive edge. They want to know the competitive pricing from the sales guys. They want to know how customer service has helped your competition to go ahead of other players. But if you talk about an ecosystem, it means you have to bring together all of these departments and you have to see them in sync with all the business stakeholders that exist in the world. So you already will have newsletters that go out to each of these departments. You will already have requests that have come in from each of these departments. But when you are doing a proactive report about the future, you have to understand how all of these departments are together steering the strategy of your competition. And how each of these elements here from the business function can relate to the stakeholder from this ecosystem. So here you would read a number of stakeholder names. Some of them are internal, some are external. While employees, your suppliers, and your alliances all come from within the company of your competition. It can also be the industry, the government, the regulations, the customers, their perception, the community in terms of the responsibility that your company has towards the community and all of that. So in this report, what we will do is to understand how different business functions come together with the different stakeholders. Okay. So when we talk about the information that comes in from each of these stakeholders, let's see how it all comes together. Let's move on to the case study now. Giving you all a small background to the business case. So Tata Consultancy Services, we provide competitive intelligence services to our clients, to our customers, to other companies. And in the case that we are discussing today, a particular firm wanted to understand how the recent and ongoing changes will affect the future market landscape. In this particular industry, there was a lot of consolidation. Talking a little more specifically about the industry that we are talking today, it's about, it's the consulting industry. It's a professional services firm. So they have consulting services. They also offer audit and tax services to the market. And these three service lines are connected in a way that, you know, while audit and taxes are more or less stable, consulting is something that's highly unpredictable, but it's still a very growing industry. You have a McKinsey, you have a BCG, you have a Bain coming together with an IBM and an Accenture. While you have technology companies like IBM and Accenture competing with pure consulting house firms like a McKinsey or a BCG or a Bain, how does it all come together? In addition to that, our particular client, he's a Big Four, which means you know, his competition is either a PwC or a Deloitte or an EY or a KPMG. So it's a very capital intensive industry. When I say capital, it's an HR, human capital intensive industry. People make all the difference to how our client would be better or will not be better in the market. And since it's a consulting industry and a human capital intensive industry, you have a number of small boutique firms that are actually a serious threat in terms of the market share for niche services. That's because when we talk about a cybersecurity service, or when we talk about cloud, or when we talk about digital, when we talk about social, when we talk about media, they're all very niche services. So small boutique firms can also pose a very serious threat when it comes to niche services. So this is the background of the client. Moving on to the next slide. What we simply did was finish the report in four phases. The information phase is the first one. This is where you have all your information from the past. It could be from 2 years, 3 years, or even 5 years in terms of a very established CI function. As you see, the number of circles here, you have tons of information here. You have a lot of information. They're all there on your computer. But when you bring together this information, the intelligence that you get out of them will be more focused, more refined, and more clear, and they will give you the direction. So your intelligence is different from information. Maybe your newsletters will have information, but this report that you are talking about today will be about intelligence and not information. Okay, so the second phase is, how do we come out with intelligence from the information that we already have? The third phase, which is the roadmap here. So from the intelligence, we say, in the past 3 years, competitor one or competitor A has done so. This is how their past looked, and this is how their future will look. And we do this for every competitor that we are studying in the report. We have information about the competition, we get their intelligence, and we say this is how they did in the past, this is what they're likely to do in the future. And from this roadmap, you come out with a strategy for your own company. As you see, a strategy has to be competitive in nature. So only when you are definite of what your competition is doing, can you decide whether you want to be a pioneer or a follower. If all your five competitors are doing almost the same thing, and you think, okay, almost all of them are going to do the same thing in the future, then you might want to move into a completely different field and you become a pioneer. Or if you think, no, I want to be one among the players, but I want to differentiate myself in this way. So this is the direct link. You understand what your competition will do, and then you come up with a strategy of your own. All right. So before we move on to the next slide, which is slide number 10, let's go back to slide number 7. Okay. Talking about information. Remember, the first phase of this report has to be the information that you have. So let's see what information you will have. Maybe we all have this, but we just don't realize. They are so deep and they're so powerful that they can answer questions which maybe a gardener or a forester will not be able to answer for us. So let's see, in simple terms, what kind of information do we have on employees? So some of the questions that you can answer about your competition. What is the quality and nature of human resources employed by your competitor? Which means, what are their degrees, qualifications, years of experience, technical skills, what university degrees they have? What are the human resource policies deployed by the competitor? Which means, in what way the employees want to join your competitor, and why don't they want to join you? Or maybe in what way are you better compared to your competition in terms of employee-friendly policies? Third question, how are employees distributed across offices and locations? And this will tell you very much in detail what kind of service delivery they have, right? Which, how many locations, how many are remote, how many are on-site, how many are off-site? The fourth question, what is the quality of work environment experienced by the employees? How do employees like your competition more than they like you? Or why do employees like you more than your competition? Next question, how is employee training and development achieved? Why do people want to join your competition? What is the competitive advantage experienced by a competitor from a human resource perspective? So you see, you may have simple information such as, are they recruited 5 vice presidents in the last 3 months? But deeper to that, you have all of these questions answered for you. What is the quality, in which department, which area is growing, why is it growing, in which region is it growing? If they're servicing from this country or if they're servicing from this city, what does that talk about the kind of clients they have? Especially if you're talking about a US market, you will be very certain that if you know they're servicing from Washington DC or Virginia, then they're servicing government clients, right? So the region from which they are servicing their clients talks very much about who their clients are, what kind of clients are they servicing. So that's the simple information. Moving on. Moving on to something like an alliance, right? So you have a simple development. You have one statement about your competition. Competitor A came up with 5 new alliances in the last 3 years. That is one statement. But how much of intelligence is embedded in that one statement? Some of the questions that you can answer is, where do your alliances and partnerships fit within your supply chain? Can your alliance or partner actually become your competitor in the future? What if they do some kind of a vertical integration that they actually become your competitor? And is your alliance or partner kind of bringing you down because he himself is not so good? What is the quality of alliances and partners your competition has? And in what way is an alliance or a partner bringing value to the services that your competition is posing? So you see, one statement can give you a lot of questions. And then you have the government, of course. You have the working regulations around coming into partnerships and technologies in different markets. So your information about alliances can actually tell you how alliances are giving competitive edge to your competition. And then talk about customers. Here you can have, you know, in-house competitive intelligence. You can even get information about what are customers thinking about your competition. What is the nature of interaction between different functions of your competition and the customer, for example? Why do customers like your competition better? Is it the sales? Is it the post-sales? Is it the pioneering that they like, the first product of its kind that ever comes out in the market? Or is it the brand value that customers are after? Is it the pricing? And the customer himself, especially if it's a B2B, the customer can become your competitor in their cases. So when you analyze your customers from information that you have from 3 to 5 years of time, it can actually tell you where you want to go in the future, right? So, so these are the kind of questions that you want answered from the information. Let's look at just one more stakeholder before we move on. Let's talk about suppliers, because this is so important. How does your competitor manage vendor relationships? This question can be answered only if you look at data over a period of time. If you looked at just one statement or one press release or 5 press releases, you will not be able to answer this question. You need to look at data from a couple of years to until about 3 to 5 years to say, how does your competitor manage supply relationships? How does a supplier's profile contribute to the risk profile of your competition? If the supplier goes down, he goes bankrupt, then what happens to your competition? Especially if it's a very capital intensive industry, then what? What is the potential of your supplier to become competition to your competitor or to you? So in every case, whether it's about employees, community, alliances, market, suppliers, customers, government, or industry, what you guys already have is information. What we are trying to deduce from that information is, how does each of these elements give a competitive edge to your competitor? What business advantage do they bring? How does it make your competition better than you? And the last one, when you bring all of this together, where is your competitor going to go in the future from the way you see it? So that is how we have connected the different functions with the different stakeholders in the intelligence stage. Okay, so we had the information, we got the intelligence. Now let's move to the roadmap phase. Here I would like to show you how we did the roadmap. Moving on to slide number 10. This is about competitor 1. Okay. Now, when you look at your competition from a superficial perspective, they all seem to be doing the same thing. But then, that's where we may be misguided, because they all seem to be. But the information that you get from their employees, the information about their alliances, the information about their industry focus, the information about the kind of people they have in their company right now, that will tell you a totally different picture. In this case study, we studied about six primary competitors, and we also shortlisted a number of new competitors in terms of firms that were performing very well. So in our case study, we considered about 10 to 15 firms or market players, and this is what we found in the roadmap stage. We found out that competitor one was driving engagement through consulting services around cloud analytics and vertical integration. Whereas if you see competitor two, he was doing technology and BPO, which means the service mechanism was different, right? So if you see competitor one, he wanted to become a pioneer. But competitor two, he was just bringing together different things, and he wanted to be a follower. He wanted to be a low-cost market player to the industry. So competitor two is very different from competitor one. Okay? But then what's common between them? Competitor one had a lot of in-house IP that he invested. Competitor two, because he was a low-cost player, got in technology from outside. He used his strategy from in-house, and he got technology from outside so that he could cut down on the R&D investments. Right? Now compare these two guys with competitor three. This guy had a pricing and sales strategy which was not found in competitor two and competitor one. So maybe their pricing is so different, they got out different pricing models, they made the customers very happy with the kind of flexible models that they offered, the subscriptions that they offered, the add-ons that customers could choose after they selected the service. So you see, on the outside, they all look like they're doing the same thing. But when you look at the intelligence, it's a totally different story. They are all running in different tracks. They are not running on the same track. Now, this is what we call intelligence. Moving on to slide number 13, let's spend a few minutes on this slide, because this is probably the most important slide of this entire presentation. As we know, you have tons of information. Let's assume you had 10 pages of information in the beginning before you started this report. You brought together all the 10 pages of information. Now you have 3 pages of intelligence. But you're presenting this to your strategy team, which means they are from the executive management. So you obviously can't apply all your 3 pages to them. They do not have the patience, they do not have the time, and they do not understand what is in those 3 pages. So you've got to come up with a story that connects the dots, a story that talks about the future with the information from the past, a story that helps your management to decide what competition will do or might do and where they want to position themselves accordingly. So your story has to be a one slider only, no matter how much information you had in the beginning, because this is now about presentation. It's no longer about intelligence. So in your presentation, you have 3 primary competitors, 3 secondary competitors, right? This warm liner that I'm going to read out to you here, it says investments in so-so-so will drive the firm's competitiveness against the big 4 and tech-centric consultancies. This one line has come from the analysis of information about maybe 5 different business functions, combining with 8 different business stakeholders over the last 3 years. So let's say That one line came from analyzing all the functions of competitor one and understanding how they interacted with the different elements of the market here. And we had so much of information, we got so much of intelligence, but from that we have to come up with one line, and that's what your executive management really needs. And that is what is presented here. Competitor three, over the last 2 years, this is what he has tried to do. Competitor two, what is he doing? He wants to become an end-to-end solutions provider. Competitor three, he's going to see double-digit growth for 4 consecutive years while it profits from tech-enabled investments. So you see, this is how they have performed in the past. Now compare these guys with your secondary competitors. There seems to be a lot of competition here, but they don't seem to be doing very well with what your primary ones are doing. For example, this guy, he has a lot of mergers and acquisitions. So when you see it on the outside, it looks like, oh, great, competitor 8, he's going to do very well in the future. Why? Because he's got a lot of firms and everything. But there's a caveat. What is it? The market is apparently getting confused with the kind of messaging that this competitor is putting out because of his numerous acquisitions and mergers. He's trying to become an everyone, jack of all, master of none. So the market is actually getting confused with what this guy is exactly doing. So when a customer thinks of the service, this guy is not somebody that is going to come to his mind immediately. Probably these are the ones that come to mind because they seem to be, because the market understands what they are doing. The market knows what this guy is doing. But here, there seems to be a lot of investment. In fact, there are in technology, software, and so on. But the messaging is very mixed. Let's look at competitor 6 and 7. They seem to have done a lot as well, but they lack the scale to take the lead. So if you're a firm with a huge enterprise and you are hearing a lot of news about your competitors 6 and 7, you need not be scared because these guys don't have the scale to compete with you head on. That's the messaging here. Competitors 4 and 5. Now these guys are focused. They have traditional solutions. But there's a limitation. They do not have the technology to run the race. Right? Your executive management asks you, I'm a competitive intelligence specialist in my enterprise for the last 2 years. What do you think of competition? These are the one-liners that would help you to position them to your executive management, and this is what they would need, right? All right, so here you have an explanation. Tier 1 player, Tier 2 player. As a competitive intelligence function, your company may be subscribing to a lot of industry reports. Dollars, you know, like 500, 200, 100, whatever, to buy these reports. But none of them would actually say this. Why? Because they have a forecasting from, from about 3 months to 1 year to 2 years. But you have raw data, and that is treasure. Raw data is always treasure because only you know how you can mix and match and squeeze it to get intelligence like this. This won't be present in the reports that we normally buy from outside. This is something that you, because of your IT, you have worked in that industry for so long. So you're saying that from what I see in the past, this is what I will see in the future. The market will be divided between tier one players and tier two players. And then there is an explanation for each of the players. You see, this line is only for this company. But when you take this entire box here, when you take this entire rectangle, this is what they are likely to do. All the big players, they have sizable investments, they have technology, they have revenue per employee which will grow. But then, as and when the companies become bigger and bigger, the margins will come under pressure, right? And then TBR, we also use TBR reports for this particular presentation. So we say that TBR predicts that tier one players will continue to take market share from so-and-so while the firm grows into a standalone company. Right? So we've used external reports as well as we've used the raw data that we had and we came up with 3 bullet points for the entire market. This is something that only a human can do. You cannot use an algorithm or a robot to say, this is what will happen in the future. You got to study this and you got to write this on your own. Coming to the secondary players. Here there's a lot of confusion. A number of people exist here, but you don't have to worry about them because they're anticipated to live in the segment, likely to retain focus on traditional strategy consulting engagements. They do not have the technology, and even if they have the technology, their messaging is very confusing and stuff like that. So you see, the market is clearly divided here. But if you saw this stage, the information stage, you won't be able to say that, you know, this is what it looked like. But now we have a definite picture. It looks like this. Correct? Moving on to the last slide of our presentation. This is the future, right? So during the during the week, what we did, existing competitors, we divided each service line because our client was of 3 service lines. We offered 3 services to the market. We said for each service line, we took our existing competitors and we made a note of their emerging competitors. And for each of these companies, we just have one line here. What's happening with existing competitors? The lighter gray with the lighter gray box, the darker blue with the darker blue box. Emerging competitors, we have considered ones that are taking away market share, that don't seem to have a lot of press, but internally they're doing very good work. Similarly for service line 2, you have, there need not be only 3, this is just for the sake of presentation. You can have more than 5 here and you can analyze all of them. And you see, this is what will happen here from the existing ones, this is what will happen here. Service line 3, you repeat the same exercise and you say existing competitors for tax, they are fast growing tax segments. The emerging competitors, big players are interested in specialized tax firms with technology capabilities. So acquisition is going to be likely happening in this area. So you see, a company that has about 35,000 employees with 3 service lines, with about 5 existing competitors and about 5 or 3 emerging competitors, and we come up with one slide. Now, this should be the essential purpose of a competitive intelligence. We don't do competitive reporting. We don't report any longer. We only deduce from now on. The reporting is there, of course, that's raw data, but a number of things can be done from the raw data. It's pressure, it's gold. So we use that to predict the future. So this 2020 is just, it can be any year. It can be 2022, 2023, 2016, 17, 18, 19, whatever. But we say 3 years from now or 4 years from now, the advisory will be a 2-tiered market. How did we get 2 tiers? We said, sure, there'll be 2 tiers. Remember? So there's a 2-tiered market for advisory. For audit, the revenues will be declining because it's more or less a very static and stable function. And the niche players will take away, or the smaller players rather, will take away the revenues from the larger players. And for tax, the service delivery matters the most. The idea of this whole slide is to help your firm to understand whether they want to move ahead with the existing players and become another player, or they want to move out of maybe 1 or 2 service lines. They want to sell away service line 1 and they want to concentrate on 2 and 3. And so this entire slide is the essence of this whole presentation. How from your newsletters, from your daily mailers, from your Gartner reports, from your TBR reports, how do you come up with a list of emerging competitors, come up with existing competitors, and see how they will all look like 4 years from now. This is the essential, this is the purpose of this presentation. So how some of the ground rules of making a report like this. The first caveat, if there is a mutual acquisition, by default we take that as a positive one. But then when you look at it from from hindsight, that acquisition may not have worked at all. It might have been a very big failure for that firm. So the You know, good practice is when you prepare a report like this, repeat this exercise every 6 months to take into account all the developments in the market in the last 6 months. Okay, so do this report twice a year, present it to your management. It's totally qualitative in nature. It's not quantitative. But then if you have a quantitative team that can validate the qualitative statements that you make here, great. Nothing like that. But then repeat this exercise every 6 months, and then you will see how your report will change. Because something that you thought was actually positive for your competitor when it happened, 6 months down the line may turn out to be negative, or may turn out to be of no significance. It might have actually caused them negative brand value. It might have got them confused messaging to the market. So you will see how your reports will change. You will change your story every 6 months. And then it will actually tell you how the past has looks like today, how the past looks like today, and how it will look like in the future. So with that, I'm done with my presentation. If you have any questions that you have for me, I would be happy to answer.
Sure. Thank you very much, Shilpa. It was a very interesting presentation. And yes, all our attendees, feel free to fire away your questions. Use the chat box, the chat function of your GoToMeeting window. We have some questions already in the pipeline, so let me read them out. And Shilpa, you try to answer them, right? So number one, how did you collect information about competitors? Assuming the question means whether it's purely secondary sources, i.e. published information, or do you do any in-depth employee interviewing or elicitation exercises here?
Okay, how do we collect information?
So I think the question is sources, approaches, okay. your sort of thinking behind that.
Let me answer this question. How do we collect the information? 60 to 70% of this information already exists in your mailbox. It exists in your newsletter. It exists in our mailers that we send out to different departments every month. But the other 30-40% has to be filled in because there will be gaps, right? So we use secondary sources, of course. So what we do is very simple. I ask my team, go to the news section of each competitor, pick up the press releases from there. Make a list of the blogs that you want to visit on a daily basis. Make a list of the social media channels that you want to bring in. Which is why if you see, the information stage is really cumbersome. It's like garbage in, garbage out, right? So what we do is at this stage, it's very important to collect everything. Because you don't know what is going to turn out to be treasure or gold in the future at your intelligence stage. You may think something is insignificant and let me leave it out. But no. Collect all the information that you get from your press releases, from your blog, from your social media channels. Also do primary interviews with people that you have access to and which is ethical and legitimate. So bring in all of your sources in the information stage. Do not discount anything because you don't know what is going to be gold in the future. Collect everything that you have and distribute your work to each of your team members or distribute your work to yourself from a departmental perspective. Okay, this is sales data, this is pricing data, this is customer data, this is service data, this is regulations data. So do that and then move on to the next phase.
Okay, understood. Thank you. Here's an add-on question to this issue, and this is, do you use any software to collect this information?
No, we don't use software in my team. Two reasons. One is because we are not a software vendor, so if we have to do that, then we'll have to check with the client. And secondly, we have found that, when we use a Factiva or when we use an Avention, it has proved to be more useful than some of the ready-to-use softwares. Of course, ready-to-use softwares have their own aims and purposes to fulfill, and that's great. But in this kind of an exercise, we did not use software for the reason that a software already comes with predetermined filters, predetermined classification of data. We wanted to see how different it would be compared to what software do. So we did all of this manually. If you're doing this exercise every 6 months, trust me, it won't be too much of information as well. You will not find it overwhelming. It is completely doable if you're doing it every 6 months without software. You can do it manually.
Okay. If I may add on a question, and this is, how do you archive then your information? Because as you mentioned, there must be many, many items, fragmented information. You somehow have to sift mm-hmm. through that and really evaluate whether it's worthwhile or not pursuing or using it. So this on its own, to my knowledge, requires some software aid.
Yes, this is something that we haven't done, but I would say it's an excellent technique and practice to follow. We can, and we should be rather, using software to archive our data. That's possible, and it will be very helpful too, instead of manual classification for later times. Yes, we can use, but we didn't use. As a team, we did not use.
Okay. Here's the next question. Do you follow any specific strategy frame when analyzing competitors' roadmaps? This refers to slide number 9. I think this was the one where you explained how to sort of progress from information to intelligence to roadmaps. So the question is, So you just pull it
slide
up
slide number 9. Okay.
Yes. So here you mentioned this. Come on. Question is, do you use?
No, we did not use. Yeah. Sorry. Go ahead.
The question is, do you use any specific strategy frame? Because you mentioned, I remember that you were deducting strategies from your from the competitors, using a roadmap approach. So what kind of strategy frame do you use here?
You can use several ones that that belong to the BCG metrics and its family. But what we rather did in our study was we classified the data, and we combined these two models here, these two figures here, and we came up with slide number 10. We did not use any framework from slide number 9. We used slide number 6, and we came up with 10.
Yes, understood. But if I may reiterate the question in my thinking, the question is whether you use any strategic concept, a strategy concept, when you deduct from intelligence to strategy, i.e. predict what a competitor's mm-hmm. strategy is all about. Obviously, there's a huge ambiguity between information, indicators, signals, and strategy. So how do you make this happen? How do you sort of pinpoint a specific competitor to be like that and not like this?
So information, it said, these are similarities and these are the differences. Of course, every company was not. There were companies that were, doing similar things, but there were companies that stood out as well. We did not follow any strategy framework, but we used only the information to go ahead with the case study.
Okay.
If that answers the question, I don't know. I don't know, rather, if there could be some good framework, There could be, of course, but we didn't use it.
Okay, fair enough. Next question. Did you apply this approach to non-service industries? So manufacturing industries and the like.
Okay. You can use this framework for any industry, of course, in its raw form. But for us, a number of departments made a lot of sense, or stood out rather, because ours was a human capital intensive industry. This was for a company that is a professional services firm. So in a raw form, yes, you can use this for a manufacturing industry. But there you will have to give more importance to other functions like your supply chain, your production, your sales, and post-sales. And you would use a lot of data, the software there if it's a manufacturing industry. You would have your customer journey, you would have your customer experience. So those would take priority over something like, you know, an HR or an operations and regulations and stuff like that. But yeah, different companies would take different levels of priority depending on the industry.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah, I think that's it. That's been all our questions coming through the chat function. Thank you very much, Shilpa. This was a very interesting presentation. I'm sure people will think about it and see how they can apply your approach to their own CI analysis kit. Yeah, thank you very much. Could you click
you
to
all.
The yeah, thank you. Could you click to the latest last slide in the presentation? There's a quick note from our end, and this is number one. I want to thank everybody for attending. This webinar is now, well, in a few days available on our website. So go for instituteforcompetitiveintelligence.com. And then check out the Insight Center, where you will see this and many other webinars in a bit. Finally, yes, there are some ICI workshops coming up. Now we're talking about the London Research Week, which you can see from November 28th to December 1st. Definitely not the nicest time to be in London, but I can promise for the workshop, it will be nice. And finally, next ICI's International conference will take place in Amsterdam, the Netherlands, May 9 to 12th. So I hope to see you there at some workshops or whenever we share some common interest. Thank you all again for attending, and thanks again for Shilpa to present this very interesting idea of strategy analysis. Thanks a lot and enjoy your day wherever you are.